Hello, my siblings in Christ, I'm Bojan, and welcome to Highway to Hell. I would say it is also Stairway to Heaven, but let us be honest. The number of people here going to heaven is for all purposes a statistical anomaly. I realize that a lot of my audience isn't Orthodox, and that the word tall house doesn't mean a whole lot to them, but the Orthodox will recognize it instantly. So, we finally got to it. The big one. The dreaded T-word of the Orthodox Church. What are the tall houses? According to a belief based on a number of visions, tall houses are a sort of demonic stations where the souls of the dead are tested for different sins. Traditionally, there are 20 of them, and failure to pass them results in damnation. Those who pass the tall houses, by repentance, prayer for the dead, and good deeds done in the honor of the departed, obtain salvation. Regarding eschatology, the Orthodox Church believes in two things: the particular judgment, where the soul is judged immediately after death, and the last judgment, where the whole humanity will be judged after the general resurrection. So, what's the controversy? People are generally very torn about them. On one end of the spectrum, we have people who think that the toll houses are a dogma of the Orthodox Church. We also have people who consider it a theolegumenon, that is, an optional belief that does not impact our salvation. And finally, on the other end of the spectrum, we have people who reject them completely, claiming that it is a Gnostic or pagan belief that crept into the church. Personally, I fall into one of the two latter categories. I don't think much of them. As with many church controversies, it is mostly language. Different people mean different things when they say toll houses. So, when the belief is rejected or accepted, it may mean a very different thing to the other person. Now, the big problem with the toll houses is that people confuse it with the particular judgment. Toll houses are one model, as it were, of the particular judgment. Particular judgment does not equate the toll houses. Let us speak what the toll houses aren't. First, they aren't visions of demons and angels approaching someone on their deathbed. People are still alive. Second, the toll houses aren't visions where demons accuse a soul of certain sins. Demons accuse, that is what they do. That has absolutely no bearing on the judgment of Christ. And third, visions where the souls of the damned are ganged up by the demons and then dragged into hell still aren't toll houses. You simply end up with the company that you preferred during your earthly life. Why am I saying all of this? Because the proponents of the toll houses like to use the visions I listed above to prove their position. However, the opponents of the toll houses, such as little old me, have no issues with those visions. So, where is the problem with the toll houses? The problem comes from their name and the vision they are primarily associated with. That is, the vision of Gregory and his mentor, Basil the New. The vision is interesting. It is nothing more than a poor, macabre, moralizing fanfiction whose intent is clearly to scare the living hell out of Christians. I call it the 20 Shades of Tall. Does it do a good job? Well, yes. Is it true? No. In fact, it is one of many, many similar writings, yet it is the only one that gets dogmatic treatment. For example, there is this story of the Mother of God going through hell, witnessing different torments and praying to God for all the sinners in hell. Christ grants that these damned souls would have a respite between Pentecost and the Day of All Saints. No one dogmatizes that vision. I will now take a look at the vision itself and make it implode. The vision begins with Gregory asking his mentor, Basil the New, regarding the fate of one of his deceased disciples, Theodora. Basil prays and Gregory receives a vision where he is served a mountain of crazy. First, he sees Theodora's death, where she is approached by none other than the Grim Reaper himself, who tears her soul from her body using different implements of torture. So, according to this vision, death is an actual creature. Oh, I can already hear you screeching. Boy, and that's symbolic. Well, here's the problem with this thinking. The vision is very, very specific what is literal and what is symbolic. The bag of gold is directly named to be prayers of Basil the New, and they'll talk about the bag too. And that is where the symbols end. Theodora is then approached by her guardian angels, and they lift her up to the toll houses, where she is taken through the 20 demonic stations to be interrogated for different sins. I would like to comment on the life of Basil the New. The text ends with him appearing in glory to a certain citizen of Constantinople in order to prove the veracity of his life. Let me put it this way in the nicest terms I can. Now, I can very easily find more people who have seen vampires in Serbia than people in the whole history who have seen Basil the New in Glory. What a great way to end the 20 Shades of Tall. So, where to begin with this? Let us begin with the bag of gold that the angels have. The dollhouses are usually compared to purgatory, and rightly so, but not for the reasons that you would expect. The bag is said to contain the prayers of Basil the New, or, in the uncensored version of the text, his merits. At no point is prayer presented as salvific love, but as currency. This is typical of beliefs that see grace as a created thing. It opposes the clear teaching that the Lord does not give his spirit out at a measure. Dollhouses are based on the doctrine of merits. In West, this teaching got rather developed and resulted, among other things, in purgatory. In East, its sole remnant are the aerial dollhouses. Speaking of which, it is interesting how salvation is presented in this vision. First, in order to be saved, you need to be a baptized Orthodox Christian. The vision is very clear that there is absolutely no hope for salvation for anyone else, ever. If you're baptized, then you enter the brownie point system. Assuming you're baptized, it essentially means that you enter a Muslim view of salvation. This kind of thinking is totally alien to Christian view of salvation. The primary work of a Christian is repentance, precisely because we fail all the time. If we were saved based on how much good we do as opposed to how much we sin, none of us would get saved. Well, okay, maybe Mother of God. Theodora is never aided by Christ in her ascension. Her sole savior is Basil the New. Angels never do anything but taking her from dollhouse to dollhouse, sprouting spiritual nonsense. Demons are the sole arbiters of who passes and who doesn't. Now, we come to the most problematic part of the dollhouses. A lot of opposition to the dollhouses claims, rightly, that demons judge the souls. And it's true, Christ never makes an appearance. Demons themselves prevent the ascension of the soul. Sin is the sole thing that matters. Good deeds and prayers and fasting are only mentioned as a way to pay the dreaded tollkeepers. Let me put this clearly. You don't owe demons anything, ever. Unless you directly sell your soul to demons, all you ever owe is to God. God gave you your life, your breath, your existence. The soul dollhouse keeper is God. That is why Christ asks those at the dread judgment, "Have you visited the sick? Have you visited those in the dungeon?" He does not go around and asks, "Did you meet a fast? Did you lie?" Christ looks for what is best in people. Demons look for what is worst. So demons do judge the soul. They prevent it from going further. And that is the biggest nail in the coffin of the dollhouse story. Why on earth would the judge and creator of the whole universe delegate the decision of our salvation to creatures he himself calls slanderers and the father of lies? If there was ever a coronation of Satan, the dollhouse story would be it. Outside of the Black Mass, there was never a greater homage paid to the unclean spirits. Words matter. You can't call Christ a prophet without demeaning his divinity. You can't call something purgatory and say you're not purged of anything there. You can't call these stations dollhouses and then calmly claim that the demons don't judge the souls there. Now I'll address the dollhouse worshippers. People who believe that the dollhouses are integral part of church teaching. These types believe that you're losing an important church doctrine if you're denying the dollhouses. Some of them will call you a heretic, the others will tell you that you're not orthodox. Are the dollhouses a dogma? No. Claiming otherwise is a flat-out lie. Visions are never a dogma of the church. Ever. Even the Apocalypse of St. John is never read in the church for this reason. Visions give people strange ideas. The creeds don't mention the dollhouses, the scripture doesn't mention the dollhouses, the councils don't mention them. Did many saints teach it? Well, many saints had different visions, and many, many do not conform to the dollhouse model, such as the vision of St. Macarius, the visions of St. Gregory the Great, and so on. Also, remember that many saints, in their humility, accepted some spurious teachings and writings. This is nothing new. The saints have believed that the writings of St. Dionysius were written by him. Now, I'm not saying that all the writings that mention the dollhouses are spurious. But if you remove all the spurious writings and all the visions that are tollhouses only by a stretch, as I mentioned at the beginning, and all the mentions of the tollhouses that are based on Gregory's story, you're really not left with much. I'd especially like to mention St. Mark of Ephesus. We call him the Pillar of Orthodoxy because he was the only bishop present at the Council of Florence who's denied the false union with the Catholics. That was the only council to deal with the state of the souls after death and before the resurrection. At that pivotal time in history, when the fate of the entire Orthodox Church depended on this one man, just when this subject is discussed, he makes no mention of this teaching that is supposed to be one of the essential doctrines of the Church, believed by everyone, everywhere, at all times. One of the things that I also find fascinating among the tollhouse activists is that they claim that the tollhouses are all over the Orthodox prayers. They're anything but. And if you compare the whole corpus of Orthodox hymnography and prayers, you're really not left with a whole lot. Just a couple of oaths from certain canons or prayers following some canons. I'd also like to comment on the proponents of the tollhouses saying that they shouldn't be taken literally. If they shouldn't, why bring up that they're mentioned in prayers? Lord, save us from the dreaded symbolic representation of our sins and passions. That is where the tollhouse proponents essentially dig themselves into a pit. Either the tollhouses are literal with all the unfortunate baggage that they bring along, or those prayers are of later date and should be discounted as fanciful insertions by people who didn't understand them properly. So, there is not a whole lot of prayers that mention the tollhouses, but iconography fares much worse. Absolutely no iconographic depictions of the tollhouses prior to 17th century Russia. And even then, they are awkwardly placed on the icons of the Last Judgment. Tollhouses, surprise surprise, are also a breeding ground for superstition. You have these made-up stories where even the Mother of God is begging Christ before her death to take her soul as she dreaded the tollhouses. She, the Immaculate Mother of God. Such blasphemy. That is some J.K. Rowling level retconning. Also, there are a number of superstitions that if you die on a certain feast day, usually Pascha, that you will skip the tollhouses. Now, with the magic of Wikipedia, I can easily look up what villains have died on specific Paschas. I really wonder what happens to them once they get to Christ. He just tells them no? And if he does, what's the point of tollhouses in the first place? So, is there some use to Gregory's vision of the tollhouses? Well, there is one. It makes a good material for examination of conscience before confession. That is where its usefulness ends. Some have said that the belief in the tollhouses is good for the soul, which is an absolute nonsense. If you believe in hell, no tollhouse will make you believe better. The antechamber to hell is never as horrible as hell itself. Christ came to shatter the works of the devil. Christ did not turn him into a civil servant of heavenly bureaucracy. Jesus did not defeat Satan in order to give him a consolation prize, to tax souls as they ascend. If you're an unrepentant sinner, you don't even begin to ascend. And if you're justified, your ascension makes the tollhouses redundant. Oh, and one more thing. It is the teaching of the Church that demons and angels don't know our thoughts. They may figure out what we're thinking based on little clues, they're older than the stars, after all, but they don't know our thoughts completely. This leaves us with one of the two options. Either Christ is in cahoots with the demons, and he provides them with records of our own sinful thoughts so they would complete their own data, or, if the tollhouses do exist, that means we won't be tormented for the sins of the thought. It is like having an 80% sin discount. Scratch everything I have said, tollhouses are great. Okay, let us assume you say, well, Boyan, what is a tollhouse model you would accept? Well, there is one I really like, as told by St. Gabriel of Georgia. Once there was this sinful woman. She decided to become a nun in order to repent of her sins. But as she was approaching a monastery, she died. Her soul stood before the Lord, with demons piling her sins and angels being practically empty-handed. Then the Lord said, "This soul is saved, for I shall accept her into the ranks of the venerable mothers." Now, this is what I like. It is Christ who renders judgment, and he can, without a word, destroy all of the demonic scrolls. The poor woman didn't answer to demons, but to Christ himself, to whom belongs all the glory, together with his Father who has no beginning, and his glorious and life-giving Spirit, both now and ever, and unto the ages of ages. Amen. I know this was a bit of a controversial video, and I apologize if some of you get offended, but then again, I get offended all the time. So it is all a game of surviving our own offenses. If you're new to the channel, remember to subscribe. If you oppose the toll houses, like I do, remember to subscribe. If you support the toll houses, I have many other videos where I don't talk about them, so remember to subscribe. In all places and at all times, and everyone should subscribe. Right now. No pressure. And when I say no pressure, I mean total pressure. There is a toll house for not subscribing. It's true. I had a vision. Bye!